Its great beauty and variety are appealing to both residents and visitors. Some of those visitors dream of making the coast their home. The dream is about a picturesque and ever-changing environment, offering dramatic landscapes and bountiful resources. But the same elements of geology and climate that make this coast so attractive are also responsible for a variety of natural hazards that can affect both people and property. Beaches give way before the onslaught of waves and currents retreating back toward the land. After the pounding of water from below and above, bluffs can slump and slide. The plans of coastal developers can be upset by the relentless forces of nature. Destructive earthquakes and tsunamis have also occurred in the past and will again in the future, though it's hard to predict when. Tsunamis, huge waves caused by seafloor earthquakes, represent the most catastrophic coastal threat. For those who need to make decisions about buying property and building on the Oregon coast, knowledge of the natural processes that affect a particular parcel of land can make all the difference between a sound and successful decision and a real headache. The constantly changing drama of ocean and land, surf and beach, is one of the enduring interests of the coast. When you understand that the drama on your local beach has a plot, it takes on a new meaning. Beach and shoreline erosion occur along much of the coast every winter. In general, beach erosion begins in October with the onset of winter storms, mainly from the southwest, that pound the coast with high winds and driving rains. High waves erode sand from the shallow underwater and from the beach. This eroded sand moves offshore to deeper water where it accumulates in bars, approximately the zone where the waves first break as they reach the coast. Sand movements reverse during the summer months when northerly winds and small waves move sand back onshore from the bars to accumulate in the beach berm. The movement of sand offshore is mainly seasonal, but it can occur any time of the year along the 360-mile Oregon coastline with high storm waves. The large, steep waves during the fall and early winter commonly erode beaches 3 to 6 feet, and as the beach progressively loses its buffering ability, property erosion becomes more likely. When large ocean waves are superimposed on high tides, significant erosion and damage to properties can occur. The wave swash may reach higher elevations on the beach and erode the toes of cliffs and foredunes. Shoreline erosion is further aggravated by the complex and large-scale oceanic and atmospheric phenomenon known as El Niño, which can result in the shoreline eroding significantly in a period of months, not decades.
El Niños typically cause as much as 30 feet of dune retreat, and those sort of processes occur roughly every 10 years or so. Change in Oregon is being driven by both episodic events that result in very significant erosion over short periods of time, but then there is this process of long-term gradual erosion that's occurring as well.
The 1997-1998 El Niño led to the most severe coastal erosion problems experienced in Oregon in recent times. But recent decades have also seen an increase in another feature of storm events.
There is certainly evidence of a long-term increase in wave heights along the Oregon coast here.
We look back at the data and discover that, in fact, the wave heights have been progressively increasing for at least 30 years.
The increased wave heights translate into more damaging storms, and storms are typically occurring earlier in the fall and later in the spring. This leads to more severe erosion, more sand lost from the beaches, and a much slower recovery of the beaches. other extreme effects are the results of local settings near the beach. Oregon State University researchers at the state-of-the-art Hinsdale Wave Laboratory are studying rip currents, which are caused by waves and are independent of ocean currents.
The rip embayment itself isn't the cause for the erosion, but it actually can give storm waves the attack at that particular location rather than someplace else. Waves can propagate through a rip embayment, which is deeper than the neighboring waters, and actually break right by the properties. They can reduce the heights of the berms. They can eat away at sea cliffs. Storm waves can attack property much easier than they would if there was the natural barrier of a berm and a beach present.
The resulting erosion is commonly limited in longshore extent to 100 or 200 yards. While ocean storms often cause erosion, it's important to recognize that they can also cause sand accumulation or even inundation. These effects can be just as troublesome to a property owner. How the Oregon coast looks and behaves today depends largely on fundamental and dynamic processes of the earth, ocean, and atmosphere. These processes affect the coast on different scales of space and time, from very small to very big. To the west of Oregon, the seafloor is slowly spreading apart along deep sea ridges at the rate a fingernail grows. The region where this slow-moving seafloor collides with the continental landmass, 20 to 40 miles west of the coast, is known as the Cascadia Subduction Zone, because the seafloor goes under the continent, lifting up the coast in certain places. A history of uplift can be seen in sea cliffs and the marine sediments they contain. The flat marine terrace is the lowermost and youngest terrace of a series that in some places form a stairway up the flank of the coast range. Their presence documents that the Oregon coast in general has been gradually rising for tens of thousands of years. Still, in the Cascadia subduction zone, what goes up does come down. During a subduction zone earthquake, some areas of the coast may subside or drop by 3 to 6 feet. Geologic evidence indicates that catastrophic earthquakes have occurred at least 6 times in the past 4,000 years, at intervals ranging from 300 to 1,000 years. Researcher Paul Komar has studied the long-term effects of such earthquakes.
The last major earthquake was in January, year 1700, magnitude 9. And the surprising thing is even though that was 300 years ago, it's still having effects on the erosion of the Oregon coast. And that's because associated with the subduction earthquake, much of the coastal area abruptly drops down by a meter or two. It's like sea level suddenly rose by a meter or two. And of course, that induced massive erosion at that time.
Coastal officials know that a tsunami would occur with a subduction earthquake, and communities are making plans to deal with this threat. Developing models of what sort of inundation would occur is part of the planning. Not only can the land sink or the sea rise in a catastrophe, the sea is likely to gradually rise during this century as a result of global warming. The scientific experts on the topic, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, have predicted that global temperatures will increase about 2 to 6 degrees Fahrenheit by the year 2100. Higher temperatures cause the ocean's surface waters to expand and glaciers to melt, among other effects, and the U.S. National Research Council has predicted that by the year 2025, the global sea level will rise by approximately 4 to 8 inches.
The expectation is that the dunes will cut back anywhere on the order of 30 to 80 feet. And then when we include the effects of these major El Nino events on top of that, we may have duned retreat that's 100 feet or more occurring over the long term.
The response of beaches on the Oregon coast to sea level rise is not expected to be the same everywhere. The reasons are complex, but in general, it is known that the far north coast near Astoria is presently rising faster than the global sea level as is the southern half of the Oregon coast, while the central coast between about Newport and Tillamook is slowly being submerged by the rising sea. While geologic, oceanic, and atmospheric processes affect the land adjacent to the sea generally, understanding how specific locations of coastline and adjacent land respond to these processes can help make a better decision when choosing a new home or building site. Nearly three-fourths of the Oregon coast is comprised of beaches backed by dunes, bluffs, or cliffs. About half of that amount is privately owned and either developed or potentially developable. All too often, homes and condominiums have been constructed immediately behind the beaches. They have also been constructed within the dunes, and most precariously, atop cliffs overlooking the ocean.
We all want to get as close as possible to the edge so that we have a good ocean view. Sometimes that's not very smart in terms of the vulnerability of a site to erosion and to the developed portion of the property, your house, your porch, your swimming pool, whatever it is you're building along the ocean.
What can prospective residential buyers do? The first thing, experts say, is to be alert to the differences between buying at the coast and elsewhere.
You come out here and what you see are expansive beaches. You see a beautiful blue ocean and a wonderful sky, and all you see is sunshine. And you can see those windows. You can envision looking out those windows of your house, and it's a gorgeous thing. And then winter comes. And then you have situations like this behind me where all of a sudden you went from having a 100-foot dune in front of you to less than 10 feet. And you are in an emergency situation.
The Oregon coast is totally different than any area on the inland. It's not like buying property in a metropolitan area, for sure. Buyers come to the beach, fall in love with the beach, and then they want to buy something at the beach. In between time, what they will do is go back to their home state, and they don't know or do the due diligence that should be done in buying property that is not in the immediate area. The best thing that any buyer can do, particularly with a residence, is have a property inspection that will give you the condition of that specific property. That's the most important step to take.
Well, there are a number of things you can do even before you buy the property. First, what it's called is due diligence. You go to your local planning office, you talk to the building inspectors, you talk to your land use planners, you talk to the state parks because they have jurisdiction over what happens along the coastline in Oregon.
The State Department of Geology and Mineral Industries produces coastal hazard maps, which also can be very useful, as they provide local information about such considerations as landslides and erosion.
My next recommendation to you would be to have a geotechnical specialist come out and look at the site. They're going to give you some information on building. They're going to give you some information on what rates of exchange of sand have happened along this coastline. They're going to look at historical photographs. And they're going to give you an idea of what you're getting into. And one of the first things you also need to ask is, can I protect my home if there's a problem?
Go to the planning department and find out if you have the ability through Oregon's land use law of doing a riprap job or providing structures in front of your home to protect it. There are a lot of places on the Oregon coast, especially newer developments, where the laws prohibit you from protecting your home if the embankment caves and you have an event that moves the ocean a lot closer to your home. So again, if you're going to get a geological report, find someone who's going to give you the truth about a property, because you want to know what's really happening.
If erosion is the problem, it may be tempting for a property owner to think about putting in riprap or other hard shore protection that fixes the shoreline in place. But there are issues with riprap.
For an individual property owner, these structures, like the one that we see here, are quite expensive. They can run up to hundreds of dollars per front foot. I've seen structures anywhere from $10,000 to up to $50,000 or $100,000, depending on the size of the property. So that's definitely a concern for a property owner. If I put in a structure and my neighbor doesn't have one, it's likely to cause additional erosion of their property. And of course, that's a problem for them. also riprap revetments and other structures, particularly seawalls, straight seawalls, can cause more accelerated erosion in front of a structure. So there's some questions about the impacts of a structure away from the property that's actually protected.
This is a particular site where we had looked at an alternative to riprap. The site was experiencing erosion. The erosion wasn't really critical enough to justify a hardened structure like riprap. So we looked at alternatives, working with the state and with the city agencies, and came up with an alternative that was softer. The alternative consists of willow plantings on top of a clay terrace that is wrapped with the geotextile fabric to protect it against erosion. It's been referred to as clay burritos. They kind of wrap like burritos with a clay content. And the idea is to protect the clay embankment long enough for the vegetation to take root. In this current application, we chose to use Hooker's willow because it's native to the environment here. It's found up and down the beaches of Cannon Beach. It's very aesthetically pleasing. It's resistant to salt spray. It's got a very strong root system. In this case, that was very important to have a strong root system because that's what's going to help resist wave energy. The plant itself also helps to resist wave energy by breaking up the waves as waves break against the slope.
If individual home buyers need to be aware of the specific features of their property, even more so to developers of residential and commercial properties. Newport banker Don Barth remembers well the fiasco of the Jump Off Joe development, which was built on an unstable bluff.
When the project started underway, it was hardly set. The concrete probably hadn't really got completely cured on some of the upper walls when the cracks began to show. And it was only, I would say, a year and a half, maybe later, that the whole thing had to be destroyed. It's just important for people to keep in mind what can happen, and this is a good example of what did happen. Bankers have a real responsibility in this as well, because it's going to fall back on them to a very large degree if they go ahead and make a loan and that turns out to be a disaster for their customer. It'll also be a disaster for their bank and probably for the individual. So you just have to be, you don't have to be so super cautious that you don't make loans, but you do have to be looking at every angle, checking with every source, checking certainly with every geologist that has done work in that area, checking with people who use that geologist and get their opinions. There's a lot of things you can do, and it doesn't all have to cost a lot of money.
Years of experience have taught Pacific City developer Jeff Shans some valuable lessons about planning coastal developments.
We have right now four projects that we've been involved with, and all of them are on sand. Three of them are right on the beach. They vary greatly in the type of project they are. Residential, one's a restaurant, the other is a lodge that we are in the process of developing. And I think probably the key thing that we've learned is that each site has its own limitations, its own kind of problems and positive features. And what we've learned is it's critically important to design the project for the site as opposed to design a project and then find a site and place it on it. And in our case, we've tried real hard to find the best consultants that we could and really listen to their advice prior to designing the project. We've found that that allows us to understand what the critical issues are and what areas that we need to stay away from physically, what areas that we can intensify development, what specific concerns there might be with regard to ocean effect or wind erosion and that type of thing.
Local governments work with developers to ensure a safe and sound project.
For most oceanfront sites, city or county would commonly require a site-specific engineering geologic report. That's not necessarily required by the state, but most local governments would impose that requirement on an oceanfront site. And those reports really are intended to assess the level and type of hazards that are present on a particular site. Those reports then are used, of course, by planners to try to ensure that adequate safeguards are provided in the development process and that resources are protected. But those reports are also a very important tool for the property owner. There is no such thing as an absolutely risk-free oceanfront development site. Some are more hazardous than others, but in general there will be risks and those need to be taken into account.
Experienced planners and developers agree that early and effective communication is key to successful development.
Dealing with the land use issues that we've faced in, on several of our projects, they're fairly rigorous effort that we had to go through. I can say that had we not approached the county in a proactive way and made a big effort to be non-adversarial, but instead to work within the ordinance, within the state regulations, and understand them, we wouldn't have gotten anywhere on a couple of our projects.
As the saying has it, the three most important things about a property are location, location, and location. When the property is on the Oregon coast, the relative safety and stability of the location are crucial considerations.
Beware about how calm and nice it looks in the summertime, because in the wintertime we have naturally higher sea levels, we have big storms that right where we're standing right now, I've seen a 2-foot swash coming up and running into this revetment here. Obviously it didn't go away, so it worked, but things are a lot different between summer and winter. And summer is when most people are out looking for property.
It's an extremely variable environment. For example, if you drive along the coast in the summer or go for a walk on the beach in the summer and then walk that same beach in the winter, they can be very different places in terms of how much sand there is on the beach. The amount of wave action you're going to see striking the beach right there.
Sound planning procedures and expert technical assistance can lead to responsible and secure building. But buyers also have a responsibility.
Use your common sense first. If it looks dangerous to you, it probably is. Just don't believe because the county or city okayed it and that there's a geologic report that says it's safe. Don't necessarily believe that. The county and cities often, they generally don't have their own expertise, and so they just assume that the geologic report is correct, and you shouldn't make that assumption.
I suggest a consulting geologist or engineering geologist to look at the site in more detail. It might be worth spending a few thousand dollars to make sure that the site you buy for $100,000 or $200,000 is actually going to be stable into the future.
The Oregon coast's special beauty will always be a magnet for new residents and visitors and the source of much needed economic development. But the same factors that contribute to its beauty also make it a little bit more difficult to build in.
One quickly learns that the Oregon coast is very dynamic. That's one of the reasons people choose to live here. But it requires making good choices. Those that have done so are able to fully enjoy it.
And think about locating a little bit farther back if you get that kind of advice. You know, I've seen people come in front of our planning commission and ask for the permission to put a structure in front of their home because suddenly the ocean is now threatening it. And we've had to turn them down, and that's not a lot of fun. So come to the coast, live and work on the Oregon coast, but do your homework.